Today we're out here showing you how we go about managing our oak forests. The first thing to talk about when we talk about managing oak are the requirements for the oak seedlings to generate. What we have when we look at any forest is a system of forest canopy layers. We call the understory, which is 10 to 15 foot tall all the way down to the ground. We have a midstory, which are the trees that have gone above 15 foot up to about 40, 45 feet, and they're hanging out with canopies, but under the mature class in the overstory. And then we have the overstory itself, which are the very mature trees that form the canopy. Our problem is oak trees like a partially shaded environment for germination. And with all of these full canopy layers we've got going on here in the control block, there isn't enough light reaching the forest floor for the acorns to germinate. It's all being sucked up by this mat of green between 15 and 45 foot off the ground. And as you can see, from about your knee down, there isn't anything on the forest floor out through this control block. No oak regeneration coming up whatsoever. The only thing we've got are hickories, elms, and gums that don't mind the shade. So, in order to convert a control block like this into a managed oak forest where we're getting ready to harvest at the end of a cycle, we do two things. We burn, and then we do a mid-story control with arsenal. And if you look on the other side, you can see a stand where we've burned twice, and then we hacked and squirted or did the mid-story control with the chemical two growing seasons. It's had two growing seasons since then. And you can see the difference. You can see that out here, the mat of green between 10 foot and 45 foot is no longer there. It's really, really open and looks like a park, giving you a lot of visibility through the woods. You can see that where on the other side, you didn't have anything green growing below the knee. On the side that's been burned and hacked and squirted, you can see that there's a carpet of green growing below the knee. A lot of this is your oak regeneration, along with other species. So we've prepared a seed bed here. We have a lot more light coming down. We have a lot more open space through the woods. We have the oak regeneration responding accordingly.
There's two times that we want to do mid-story removal with herbicide injection. One of those times would be if we simply want to do a forest stand improvement, where we're trying to improve our species composition and improve the overall value and health of our stand through those means. The other time, as we're talking about today, is through natural regeneration site preparation, if you will. And that's what I'm going to talk about, kind of the how, the what you use, those types of things. And so we're talking about removing non-merchantable stems from 1 to 5 inches in DBH. So we're not talking about anything that a harvester could come in and take out of the stand. It's really a simple operation. The chemicals that we use are not restricted. Anyone can purchase them and use them. And the tools you need really aren't that complicated. You need this is what we call hack and squirt. And so you really just need a hatchet and a squirt bottle. And there are different chemicals that we can use. And some help us. One of the big issues we have with hack and squirt operations or injection operations is the amount of time it takes to work through a stand. That time is money a lot of times if you hire a forester to do this. And so we want methods where we can work through these stands with relative ease and not take too long. Because if you have 40 or 50 acres that you're trying to do injection work on, you don't want to spend all day just doing a few trees here and there. And so there are different chemicals that we use, and I do recommend that you go to the University of Arkansas Cooperative Extension Service, MP553. This is forestry herbicide prescription for the Western Gulf region. And in here we have a section called individual plant treatments, and it walks through the different chemicals that are available to foresters and forest landowners to do this mid-story injection work. Three of the primary chemicals that we use are imazapyr, glyphosate, and triclopyr. And here on the station, we primarily try to use imazapyr as the product. And the reason for that, it goes back to my discussion on the amount of time it takes to get through the forest. And imazapyr is a chemical that allows us to do what we call wide spacing injection. And so if I was going to inject this tree is less than 3 inches in DBH, and so it would only get one hack and 1 milliliter of my solution. And so you can go ahead and demonstrate. So we're gonna put literally one hack and one squirt, and we're moving to the next tree. Some of the other chemicals require us to girdle the entire tree, such as triclopyr. And then, you carry that throughout the forest and you're girdling every tree, you can see the difference in time it would take in labor to get through the stand, not to mention more chemical and that type thing. So yes, we like to use imazapyr, but there are times when we want to use products like triclopyr and glyphosate. The reason for that is imazapyr was developed to kill hardwood trees. And so if we're injecting imazapyr into this tree right here, you can see we have large oak trees nearby. And if imazapyr gets into the soil, that tree could absorb that chemical and it could cause damage or kill your overstory trees. So whether you or you have an injection crew working with imazapyr in your forest to do injection work, you need to understand and be experienced in making that application. If you're out here being sloppy with your application or squirting the chemical on the ground, you could actually be killing your overstory trees using imazapyr. So there is that caveat. We need experienced injection crews to use imazapyr. But if we can, we really want to go that route because it has a wide efficacy range of different species that it controls, much more than the other two chemicals, and it's mainly just the time factor of moving through the site. You might say, when are those times when I wouldn't want to use imazapyr? If I have an inexperienced crew or I'm really concerned about getting chemical into the soil, then those other two chemicals we mentioned, the triclopyr and the glyphosate, neither of those have soil activity. And so I can be as sloppy as I want. You don't want to be sloppy with those either, but I could be as sloppy as I want with those and I'm not going to damage my overstory. And so that's really a decision you have to make on your own as to what your resources are and what your capabilities are. But if you're hiring someone, a professional forester, to come in and do your injection work, they should be able to run with the imazapyr and save you some time and money.
The first and most important thing to know when you're going to do the actual work of the hack and squirt is type of squirt bottle. Like the squirt bottle that I have here that has the chemical in it, I don't know how well you can see it on the camera, but internally there's a pumping mechanism so that when I pull the trigger, the pump compresses in a vertical motion, pulling the chemical up and into the feeding tube and out the squirt bottle. On this cheap piece of junk, what you can see is you've got a plunger here so that when you pull that squirt bottle, it compresses a plunger. And then when you release the trigger, the suction created by the plunger coming out is what pulls the chemical up and out of the squirt bottle. This is garbage. At the end of the first day you use one of these, that arsenal is going to get into the cylinder where that plunger fits. It's gonna get sticky, it's gonna gum up the works, and by the end of the day, you're not getting a full 1 milliliter trigger pull when you pull. You're getting half, maybe even a third. I've had them get so gunked up that they don't even spray. So you most definitely wanna make sure that you have one of these internal pumping units. This will make your life a whole lot easier. Now, hatchets. I like to keep my hatchet at a razor sharp level. The reason being, in the winter when I'm out here doing my hack and squirt, if you come up to a hickory that's frozen and you don't have a sharp, heavy hatchet, you're just gonna be bouncing off the bark all day long. Matter of fact, I carry a whetstone with me, and over the course of a strip, I'll stop and do a quick touch-up on my hatchet just to put that edge back in there. When you're doing the hack and squirt, what I like to do is up next to where you're gonna start, like here we have a convenient roadway. So if I was hacking and squirting this section of timber, I would come along and where I was gonna start my strip, one hack facing the road and injected. Then I would come back in, one more hack facing the road and injected. And the reason I'm doing this is so that as I'm walking down, I can see the edge of the strip where I've been in the past. Once I get about 10 foot into the woods, and I know that from the edge, I can see the edge of my strip, I flip back over and I start hacking following the way that I'm going into the woods. So that when I get down to the end of my strip and turn around to come back, I have my hacks looking at me, setting up the edge of where I've been. And then I'm going to hack again, following me, so that when I get down this way, I can look back and I can see where the edge of the strip that I've done is. And then you just keep working your way back and forth with your strips touching until you cover the entire acreage.
Mike mentioned that we use prescribed fire regularly here on the station, and we do. But we don't just run out and burn just because we want to or just because it's a good burn day or anything like that. Our fires are very objective specific, and we do them at specific times of the year. And I'll talk about that more, but one of the reasons that we use fire in our natural regeneration objectives is that oak seedlings are tolerant to fire. And so even if I have a fire come through this stand and it top kills the oak seedlings, they're capable of resprouting after the fire and really being more vigorous post-fire than they were before the fire came through the stand. Some of the other species that we are not wanting to manage for, such as the elm and the maple and those types of things, dogwood, are not tolerant to fire. And so if we can run a couple of fires through one of these stands, a lot of times we can start to shift the species that are present in the regeneration pool over time, and that gets us ahead when we get ready to take the overstory off in a clear cut. One of the reasons I say we can't just burn all the time in a hardwood stand is that oak trees are thin bark compared to conifer species such as pines that we have in the state. And if we run a fire through here during the fall of the year, late summer, those are going to be really hot fires. And we run the risk of damaging or killing a lot of our overstory trees if we burn at the wrong time of the year, or if we have heavy fuel loads in a stand, we have to be really cautious about when we burn that stand. All of our burns here on the station in the hardwood forest are conducted what we call cool season. And so typically that's gonna be the end of January through the first week of March or second week of March, right in that range. And so we have good burn conditions, everything's still dormant, and we're using those cooler days to keep the fire temperatures down so that they're not damaging our overstory. And that's really important. But the most important take-home point I can give you on our prescribed burning is that make sure your burns are objective-driven, whether it's to reduce vegetation, to increase sunlight for wildlife habitat, or oftentimes for what we're doing here with preparing the stand for natural regeneration. There are other times as well, but we don't want to just run out and use fire recklessly in a hardwood stand.